गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन, दिस इज क्लास 12th सब्जेक्ट केमिस्ट्री, चैप्टर नंबर 1 सॉलिड स्टेट, लेक्चर नंबर 2। इन दिस लेक्चर आई शैल डिस्कस क्रिस्टल लैटिसेस एंड यूनिट सेल्स एंड इन द एंड आई विल डिस्कस द होमवर्क सॉल्यूशन ऑफ लेक्चर नंबर 1। इन लेक्चर नंबर 1 वी डिस्कस द क्लासिफिकेशन ऑफ क्रिस्टलाइन सॉलिड्स एंड द डिफरेंस बिटवीन क्रिस्टलाइन एंड अमॉर्फस सॉलिड। Now next is crystal lattices and unit cells. So first of all, we need to know what is a crystal lattice. Crystal lattice is a three-dimensional arrangement of constituent particles in a crystal. As we know that in crystalline solids, the constituent particles, they are arranged in a regular pattern and the range is long range order. Now crystal lattice is defined as the regular three-dimensional arrangement of points in space is known as crystal lattice. There are 14 possible three-dimensional lattices and these are called Brevis lattices. So here in this figure a portion of three-dimensional cube lattice is given, and if we repeat this unit that is represented by this orange color, so if we repeat this unit in all direction, here we are getting the entire lattice. So this is the smallest and repeating unit in this entire crystal lattice. This smallest and repeating unit is known as unit cell. Next is characteristics of crystal lattice. So here some characteristics of crystal lattice are given. First is, each point in a lattice is called lattice point or lattice side. So here this portion is given, that is one portion of a three-dimensional cubic lattice. Now in this crystal lattice, each point, the points, these are the points which are denoted by these spheres. Each point in a lattice is called lattice point. These points are known as lattice points. Now next is, each point in a crystal lattice represents one constituent particle, which may be an atom, a molecule or an ion. So first point is, these spheres, these represent lattice point, and in this crystal lattice these points, they represent one constituent particles. It can be atom, molecule or an ion. Third point is, lattice points are joined by straight lines to bring out the geometry of the lattice. That is, if we join these lattice points by straight lines, so we will get the entire geometry of the crystal lattice. So these are the three characteristics of crystal lattice. So here I am repeating, crystal lattice is the three-dimensional arrangement of constituent particles, that is crystal lattice, and these are the characteristics of crystal lattice. First is, each point in a lattice is called lattice point or lattice site, and each point in a crystal lattice represents one constituent particle, which may be an atom, a molecule or an ion. Next is, these lattice points, they are joined by straight lines to bring out the geometry of the lattice. Now next is, what is unit cell? So as we have discussed that this is the portion of a crystal lattice, and when we repeat this unit, so we are getting the entire crystal. So we can see that this unit is the smallest and the repeating unit in this entire crystal lattice. So the smallest and repeating unit is known as unit cell. So we can define unit cell as, unit cell is the smallest portion of a crystal lattice which, when repeated in different directions, generate the entire lattice. For the understanding of this term unit cell, we can take one more example. So consider the example of a room. As we know that room is made up of bricks, that is a regular and repeating pattern of bricks result in the formation of a room. So for a room, we can say that the brick is the smallest and repeating unit. So we can call brick as a unit cell for the room. So unit cell is the smallest portion of the crystal lattice, which when repeated in different directions generates the entire lattice. Now the unit cell is characterized by its dimension and the angles between the edges. That is, so here one unit cell is given. These are the edges, that is A, B and C. And these are the angles alpha, beta and gamma are the angles between these three edges. So unit cell is characterized by its dimension, that is edge length A, B, C, and the angles between these edge lengths, that is alpha, beta and gamma. Therefore, a unit cell is characterized by six parameters, that is A, B, C edge length and alpha, beta, gamma are the angles. So up to now we discussed two things, crystal lattices and unit cells. Crystal lattice is the three-dimensional arrangement of constituent particles in space, that is crystal lattice, and unit cell is the smallest portion of crystal lattice, which when repeated in different directions generates the entire lattice. Now first of all, I will explain some basic information about a cube, and after that we will move to next topic, that is primitive and centered unit cells. So in a cube there are 8 corners or 8 vertices, there are 6 faces present on a cube and there are 12 edges. Now here is the box. Now this box is open from one side. Now if we want to define the 8 vertices of a cube, so 1, 2, 3, 4 and 4 on the back side. So there are total 8 vertices in a cube. Now if we talk about the faces of a cube, so there are 6 faces in a cube. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6th is on the lower side of this cube. So there are total 6 faces in a cube. Next is, if we talk about the edges of a cube, so there are 12 edges in a cube. Unit cells can be broadly divided into two categories, that is primitive and centered unit cells. So primitive and centered unit cells are the type of unit cells. First is primitive unit cells. When the constituent particles present only on the corner position in a unit cell. So when the constituent particles in a unit cell is present only at corner position, then those are known as primitive unit cells or simple unit cell. So here this is the unit cell and the particles are present only at the corners. So we can call it as primitive unit cell. Second type is centered unit cells. When a unit cell contains one or more constituent particles present at positions other than the corner in addition to those at corners, it is called a centered unit cell. So in centered unit cells, the particles, they are not only present at corners but at some other position also. They are known as centered unit cells. And in centered unit cells, there are three types: body centered unit cells, face centered unit cells and end centered unit cells. So first is body centered unit cells. In body centered unit cells, the constituent particles, they are present at all the corners and one constituent particle is present at the center of the body. That is known as body centered unit cell. Next is face-centered unit cell. In face-centered unit cell, the particles are present at the corner as well as at the center of each face. Now, in a cube, there are total 6 faces. So, 6 constituent particles are present at the center of each face. Third is end-centered unit cells. In end-centered unit cells, particles, they are present at corners as well as on the opposite two faces. that is known as end-centered unit cells. So there are seven types of primitive unit cells. First is cubic, tetragonal, orthorhombic, hexagonal, rhombohedral, monoclinic and triclinic. These are explained on the basis of dimensions and the angles, that is alpha, beta and gamma. First is cubic primitive unit cell. In cube, the edge length, that is A, B and C, all the three are equal and the angle, that is alpha equals to beta equals to gamma, that will be equal to 90 degree. Second is tetragonal. In tetragonal, A equals to B but not equals to C, and the angle is alpha equals to beta equals to gamma, that is 90 degree. And the example of tetragonal is white tin, TiO2, calcium sulfate. And the example for cubic system is NaCl, zinc blend, copper. Third is orthorhombic. In orthorhombic, these edge length, they are not equal to each other, that is A is not equal to B, is not equal to C, and the angles are alpha equals to beta equals to gamma, that is 90 degree. And the example of orthorhombic is rhombic sulfur. Now fourth is hexagonal. In hexagonal, the edge lengths, that is A equals to B but not equals to C, and the angles are alpha equals to beta, that is 90 degree, and the gamma angle is 120 degree in hexagonal. And the examples are graphite, zinc oxide, cadmium sulfide. Next is rhombohedral or trigonal. In rhombohedral or trigonal, the edge length, the relation between edge lengths is A equals to B equals to C, and the angles are alpha equals to beta equals to gamma but not equals to 90 degree. And the example is calcite, that is CaCO3. Next is monoclinic. In monoclinic, the edge lengths, they are not equal to each other, that is A is not equal to B, not equal to C, and the angles are alpha and gamma equals to 90 degree, whereas beta is not equal to 90 degree. And the last system is triclinic. In triclinic, the relation between edge lengths are A is not equal to B, not equal to C, and the angles are also not equal to each other, and they are not equal to 90 degree. That is, alpha is not equal to beta, is not equal to gamma, and these angles are not equal to 90 degree. So these are the seven types of unit cells, that is primitive unit cells. We know that any crystal lattice is made up of large number of unit cells, and every lattice point is occupied by one constituent particles. It may be atom, molecule or ion. Now let us work out what portion of each particle belongs to a particular unit cell. So in this case, we shall consider three types of unit cells, and for simplicity we are assuming that the constituent particle is an atom. Next topic is number of atoms in a unit cell. So next topic is number of atoms in unit cells. First is primitive cubic unit cell or simple cubic unit cell. Primitive cubic unit cell is the unit cell in which the particles, constituent particles, they are present only at the corners. So we will calculate the number of atoms in a unit cell in primitive cubic unit cell. Primitive cubic unit cell has atoms only at its corner. Each atom at a corner is shared between 8 adjacent unit cells. This is one unit cell. Now this one corner, it is shared between 8 adjacent cells. Now if we have a unit cell in this side, so this corner is shared between, this corner is shared in that unit cell. If we have a unit cell in this side, so again this corner is shared in this unit cell also. And if we have a unit cell here, so again this corner is shared between this unit cell. So total four, so this corner is shared in four unit cell and four on the above. above layer. So we can say that this one corner is shared between 8 adjacent unit cells. Therefore, the contribution of this one corner atom in a unit cell, in that is in one unit cell, it is given by, there are total 8 corners in a cube and the contribution of one corner is 1/8 in one unit cell. Therefore, total number of atoms in one unit cell is 8 × 1/8, that will be equal to 1. So number of atoms in primitive cubic unit cell is 1 atom. That is, in one unit cell, the total number of atoms is 1 in case of primitive cubic unit cell. Again, I am repeating, this one corner is shared between 8 adjacent unit cells. One, if we have unit cell in this side, so this corner is shared in this that unit cell. 2, 3 and 4 in itself in this unit cell, and 4 on the above layer. So this one corner is shared between 8 adjacent unit cells, and the contribution or the number of atoms in one unit cell in case of primitive is 8 × 1/8, that will be equal to 1, that is total number of atoms is 1 atom. Now next is body centered unit cell. In body centered unit cell, the constant particles, they are present at all the corners and as well as at the center of the body. So the contribution of corner constant particles is 8 corners into 1/8 per corner atom, that will be equal to 1 atom. Now if we are taking this as a unit cell, so this is the center, or you can say this is the body center of this unit cell. Now if the constant particle is present at its body center, then the contribution of this constant particle is 1. That is, one body center atom, 1 × 1, that will be equal to 1. So the total number of atoms in a body centered cubic unit cell is 2 atoms. One atom from the corners and one that is present at the body center. Third is face centered cubic unit cell. In face centered cubic unit cell, the constant particles, they are present at corners as well as present at the center of each face. Now in a cube, there are total 6 faces. So 6 constant particles will present at the center of 6 faces. Now one face is shared between 2 unit cells. So here 2 unit cells are given and this face, it is shared between 2 unit cells. So the contribution of constituent particle present on the face, that is half-half in both the unit cells. So there are total 6 faces. Or we can say that total 6 constituent particle, that is atom, are present at 6 faces and the contribution of one face is 1/2. Therefore, the total number of atoms due to face contribution is 6 face centered atoms into 1/2 atom per unit cell, because one face is shared between 2 unit cells. That will be equal to 3. So the total number of atoms per unit cell in face-centered cubic unit cell is contribution of 1 atom from the 8 corners and 3 atoms from the face. So total number of atoms per unit cell in face-centered is 4 atoms. In simple cubic unit cell, total number of atoms in a unit cell is 1. In body-centered unit cell, total number of atoms in a unit cell is 2, and in face centered unit cell, the total number of atoms in a unit cell is 4. So after doing this, you can solve NCERT in text question number 10, 11, 12 and 13. Now I will be discussing the homework solution of lecture number 1. NCERT in text question number 1, why are solids rigid? The answer for this question is, in solids, the constituent particles are very close packed, and the constituent particles in solids have fixed position and can only oscillate about their mean position. Hence, they are rigid. Next question is, why do solids have definite volume? In solids, the constituent particles have fixed position and are not free to move about. That is, they possess rigidity, and that is why they have a definite volume. Third is, classify the following as amorphous or crystalline solids. So here some examples are given. Out of these, naphthalene, benzoic acid, potassium nitrate, copper. These are crystalline solids, and polyurethane, teflon, cellophane, polyvinyl chloride, fiber, glass. These are amorphous solids. Next question is, why is glass considered a supercooled liquid? Glass is an amorphous solid, and amorphous solids have tendency to flow. That is why glass is known as supercooled liquid. Next question is question number 5th. Refractive index of a solid is observed to have the same value along all direction. Comment on the nature of the solid. Would it show cleavage property? So in this question, refractive index, it is a physical property, and the refractive index of a solid is observed to have the same value along all direction. By this statement, we can conclude that the given solid is amorphous solid, because in amorphous solid, these properties like refractive index, electrical resistance, that is, these physical properties have same value in all directions in case of amorphous solid. Next is, would it show cleavage property? The answer is, it does not show clean cleavage. That is, when we cut amorphous solid with a knife, irregular surfaces are obtained. Therefore, the cleavage of amorphous solid is not clean. Next question is question number 1.6. Classify the following solids in different categories based on the nature of intermolecular forces operating in them. On the basis of intermolecular forces, there are four types of, or we can say that there are four categories. First is potassium sulfate. Potassium sulfate is an ionic solid. Tin. Tin is a metallic solid. Next is benzene. Benzene is a molecular, and molecular it is nonpolar. Next is urea. Urea is also molecular, but it is a polar molecule. Next is ammonia. It is also the type of molecular solids, and in molecular solids, hydrogen bonded. Same with water, it is hydrogen bonded. Next is zinc sulfide. Now zinc sulfide is ionic solid. Next is graphite. Graphite is a covalent or network. Rubidium is a metallic. Argon is molecular, and in molecular it is nonpolar. And the last is silicon carbide. Silicon carbide is covalent or network solid. Next question is question number 1.7. Solid A is very hard electrical insulator in solid as well as in molten state, and melts at extremely high temperature. What type of solid is it? So the solid A is covalent or network type solid, because covalent or network type of solids has the property that they are hard electrical insulator in solid as well as in molten state, and the melting point is extremely high. Next question is question number 1.8. Ionic solids conduct electricity in molten state but not in solid state. Explain. In molten state, ionic solids dissociate to give free ions and hence conduct electricity. However, in solid state, the ions are not free, as these ions are not free, but they are held together by strong electrostatic forces of attraction. That is, these ions, they cannot move and therefore they cannot conduct electricity in solid state. So ionic solids in molten state, the ions are free, that is why they conduct electricity. But in solid state, the ions are not free, that is why ionic solids do not conduct electricity in solid state. Next question is, what type of solids are electrical conductors, malleable and ductile? The answer for this question is metallic solids. Metallic solids has the property that they are electrical conductors, malleable and ductile. Next is NCERT exercise questions. Question number 1. Define the term amorphous. Give a few examples of amorphous solid. Amorphous solids are those solids in which the constituent particles may have a short range order but do not have a long range order, and the constituent particles, they are arranged in a disordered manner, and the amorphous solids, they have irregular shapes and are isotropic in nature. Example of amorphous solids are glass, rubber, plastics. Next question is question number 2. What makes a glass different from a solid such as quartz? Under what conditions could quartz can be converted into glass? Glass is an amorphous solid in which the constant particles, that is SiO4, have only a short range order. In quartz, the constant particles SiO4 have short as well as long range order. Now, on melting quartz and then cooling rapidly, we can convert quartz into glass. Next question is question number 3. Classify each of the following solids as ionic, metallic, molecular, network or amorphous. First is tetraphosphorus decoxide. So this is molecular solid. Next is ammonium phosphate, NH4 thrice PO4. It comes under ionic solid. Third is silicon carbide. It is network solid. Fourth is I2. It is molecular, and in molecular it is nonpolar. Fifth is P4. P4 is also molecular solid. Sixth is plastic. It is amorphous solid. Next is graphite. Graphite is covalent or network solid. Then brass. Brass is a metallic solid. Rubidium is also a metallic solid. Lithium bromide, it is an ionic solid. And the last is silicon, it is covalent solid. So these are the questions I gave you in lecture number 1. Thank you, and please like.